Well, my dear friends, it's so nice to have you here. It's a special event, even if you don't really are into Christmas. Well, it depends on who you are. Some definitely aren't, some are not. And some are in a different way. Finally, the gathering, it's a virtual gathering. It's a little bit of virtual, but it goes back on reality. Some invitation I got, and it's the same procedure as last year, as they say. And you see it, it's a European thing. Why do you see it? Well, it's the long table. Even if we are in China, in Asia, where we do not have this supposedly Christian tradition, there is this, well, I wouldn't say mission statement that we are European. We are just European and stick to our traditions, stick to what we know or how we behave, and there is conversation between us, but it is between us. It's not a common ground, not yet, not for most of us. Actually, I'm wondering, those times when you lived, if it had been the same, or if it was just what Maine said, its status. It's not contract, it's not bound to the nation state, it's not bound to anything like it. It is just the status then of the better off. Well, not better off in terms of education, better off these simply intellectuals. Brecht was writing something very nice about it. The intellectuals sitting down and doing intellectual work for others. Writing letters. If you imagine this, writing a love letter for somebody you don't know, because you are asked to write a love letter, or express your sorrows, your mourning, because you cannot express it yourself, you ask somebody who is intellectual, who is there to write letters, to think for you. Well, you had been part of this intellectual group. So perhaps you didn't know this, at least not in this way of course, yes. There is this Christian tradition, and there is, I'd say, the other. One of the founders actually sits amongst us, Confucius, you know it. There is a strand of thinking now. Some people say it is actually a religion. I don't know. But let's come back to our meeting today. We are sitting here, a long table. And actually, before we arrived, we had been asked, what do you want to eat? There's a certain choice. It's a kind of planned thing. And you go there, you order your meal before, because it's kind of large group, and, well, the kitchen has to know. Of course, they have to know. Because they have to plan. Now, still, it's kind of different, at least from my experience today. You go for a meal with a large group, it doesn't matter, and you get actually not a dish for yourself. Mind, I don't want to say this is the right, this is the wrong thing. I don't want to offend anybody. I'm glad, I'm happy for this invitation, or for these invitations from wherever they come. But there is this difference, and there is this difference as well that you sit together, you don't have here, now I say here in Asia, this one person, one dish. That's this typical, I guess, typical property thinking that founded actually already before capitalism, before modernity, before the invention of the I, Monsieur, he isn't here, but it was there as a tradition of a very person-oriented behavior, thinking. Now, come on, Karl Friedrich and Nico, come on, sit with us together, not there in the back row. But anyway, I guess I know what you mean. It's Matthew 19:30, right? Yeah, you may be right, but a great number who are first will be last, and some who are last will be first, isn't that, Matthew? And indeed, looking at history, history isn't democratic. History about power, it's about not, it's funny, it's really funny. Right now, whom do we see? Right now, of course, who is joining us? Hegel. It's the cunning of reason. Isn't that what you said? The cunning of reason is coming, reasoning us, and bringing us this great idea as a leading, universally leading guidance. Oh, Hegel, I don't think so. It's the cunning of foolishness. No, don't run away. No, it's fine. Stay here, stay with us. But I guess it is the cunning of foolishness, not the cunning of reason. History isn't democratic. History is, well, what is it? Full of power relationships, full of contradictions, and something where we have to think about what we are actually doing with our life in our societies. And Christmas is at least supposedly this opportunity. Once a year at least, we take it and celebrate peace and celebrate reasoning, not in terms of this rationality, but reasoning in terms of stepping back and saying there is something in life that is not about. Brecht, again, he was writing this, I only remember this one line, issue, the elephants being driven, being pushed to work harder, Herr Jinn hat einen Wald, Mr. Jinn has a forest, and all work has to be done before dawn. Christmas is different. There's no work, there's just consideration, there is conversation, there is reflection, and there is the hope of conversion afterwards. In this way, actually, a circle, sitting in a circle, would be much better. The row, you need one person who is responsible or who is the leading figure. In a circle, kind of, you have this mutual control. Everybody is controlling everybody. Everybody is looking in the face of everybody else. Can't even reason, okay, I accept this. Hegel, if you want to go, just go. So us again, this opulent meal, I really love it, indulging in all these variety of things, of beautiful things we usually don't have throughout the year. That's what Christmas dinner actually I like about Christmas, some festivities like Spring Festival we have here. It's an opportunity really to indulge in these things we don't have. Conversation, as I said, reflection. Forget about the conversion at the moment, just enjoy life as it is. Now, I really don't want to spoil anything, but if you look at the table, in 2020, no, this is very expensive. Everything is very expensive and very costly, very valuable. And if you look ahead in 2020, foodstuff won't, even this luxurious foodstuff, won't be as expensive as it is today. It is kind of affordable if you look at the income of a household and what people spend for food. It will be less. In 2020, it will be less, and food will be cheaper. But there is a problem with it. Do you know what farmers then will receive? Farmers getting the major share today, then they will receive only 25% of what we pay for our groceries. Now, it's not quite as this, but today they would receive 100%, then only 25%. Imagine. And this is why food will be much cheaper then. And food will come throughout the year from all over the world. So people will say, buy locally, buy regionally. This is the real thing. There is what is value for money. But even there you have a paradox. Of course you have to pay for the transport, and there is the emission due to the transport. But the food produced regionally, locally, but still throughout the years, is produced in greenhouses, huge greenhouses. We cannot imagine today what these greenhouses are about. Actually, I can imagine. I was flying into Amsterdam at some stage, across the fields, they grow tulips there in that area, and saying across the fields, meaning across glass windows of greenhouses. There is not much green, really. So, what we have our bellies, flab of affluence, of a good life that we have as intellectuals. Okay, some of you are very slim, don't you? Yes, it must be the stress you have with your Divine Comedy. But anyway, it's not due to overeating, it's just a good life, a flag of affluence. And it will be many times again in history. But what they have then with this cheap foodstuff and junk food is just sediments of societal waste, of making profit from something that is not worthwhile actually to be eaten. But there is another price to it. It is the lack of time to reflect, to converse. Although some people will speak actually of a communication society, everybody is communicating with everybody else. There's information coming all the time. If you have a glimpse into the future, you will see information on screens and you have to listen to it. And it's not just one piece of information, it's a multiple kind of shooting, bombarding with different information at the same time. And of course, this brings us together. This brings us together with different worlds, and otherwise we wouldn't sit here. Of course, Marco Polo, traveling the world even in this inconvenient way. But at that time, it was kind of uncommon to travel really in this way. And still there was this idea of harmony. Of course. Well, Immanuel Kant, I know you didn't mean harmony, you meant the rational thinking of an eternal peace. It was this strange thing of being morally good, but at the same time not being based, this goodness, my godness, goodness not being based in godness, but goodness being based in the rationality, in rational thinking. And we all had been striving for it in different ways. Gauss as Galileo, and Marco Polo by, similar to Humboldt, traveling the world. You know who is around. And you know as well the price that had to be paid for this strictness. Sorry, Confucius. Yes, it was a bureaucratic system. It was following rules, and it was actually difficult, wasn't it, to enter. It was a small elite, and this was what it was about. Now, Immanuel, you thought there is an eternal peace not based in the idea of harmony, but based in the working together, in the coming together, and having a world government. A world government that is not concerned with administration, but if you want, well, he's gone here, but if you want, it was the absolute idea already, not as an idea, but as reality. What do we have? Conflicts. Yes, Kant. I'm sorry to say, conflicts, inner conflicts, social conflicts, social tensions, and international wars, concerned with power, striving for power, concerned with economic interest, of course, they always play the major role. And concerned with what you never really could solve. Concerned with the conflict, the ongoing conflict between morality and rationality. And the conflict, if you want, within morality and within rationality. Of course, you have been right. Never lie. Never tell a lie. If you once tell a lie, the entire system is becoming fragile. But I'm afraid your man who is facing then the man with the axe, standing in front of him and saying, well, Kant said, I'll never tell a lie, and this is what brought me here. You will be cursing him. You will say, oh, why didn't you tell a lie once? It would have saved me. Not a lot, but everything, my life. So conflicts, and I think part of what we face now is exactly the conflict art films. Don't be fooled. And gone. And this is exactly what I mean. It is actually this conflict or the lack of readiness to stand and really to discuss these contradictions. To say they are there and we have to cope with them. There is no escape. There is no Christmas. There is not one day where we can say these conflicts don't exist. We can put them aside, okay. But we have to be ready to face them, to speak about them, and to be open about it. And then harmony actually means not necessarily eternal peace, but eternal readiness to engage in this conflict. The readiness to... No. At the beginning, Gauss and Machiavelli, come on and join us. Don't sit in the back. No, you are sitting actually in the forefront. It's somewhat strange, isn't it? Now, while I'm talking about the conflict, you are stepping forward. But actually, it is exactly this, not the readiness to permanently engage in the struggle for law, not permanently engage in a productive way with working with contradictions, but it is about making everything calculable. And executing power. the power of mathematics. Far ahead, it will be the power of algorithms and the power of political structure. And this is what seems to be neutral, the power of administrations. Now, my little speech, my little toast. I love this one. I will go soon to Russia. There we have this engagement. Actually, the toast is possibly the most important part of at least workshops, where you have a small group of, let's say, 20 people, 30 people. Dinners take very, very long. And just to be on the safe side, you don't have to drink with every toast. You pretend, yes, but there's water, it looks like vodka. But a good speech is something that is really important for us. In Russia, when we meet, it's not just small talk, it is not just kindness, it is a reflection. It is about conversation. And it is about conversion, giving some impulse what to do. And in the light of above considerations, it may be concluded that the elaboration of a rigorous theory of individual or human rights is not very useful, and that a practical commitment to the actual application of rights is sufficient. Bobbio himself seems to agree with this pragmatic stance. It is unquestionable that the legitimization of individual rights cannot but be historical and contingent. And I may add, it is not simply about human rights as individual rights of as rights of individuals, but it is about the rights of societies. And perhaps if we meet again, perhaps we have a round table then. Anyway, for today it's fine. Grand cheers. Thank you.